In this video, I will try to explain the concept of decorators in Python. Okay, so decorators are not only existing in Python, and you can achieve the same behavior that Python does in any object-oriented language. And a decorator is basically similarly to a context manager. It puts some behavior around an object, and so it adds something to an object, or rather, in this case where we use it in Python, to a function. And adds behavior to it transparently. So we take a function and we add, so we can add stuff before and after the actual execution of the function. And with this, for example, we could, for example, check the arguments of a function before we actually pass it to them. So we use it when we want this, whatever we are doing, we want to have this reusable. So for example, if in your entire programming language, you never want to use negative numbers. For every single function call, you want, for example, to check if a number is negative, and if so, you want to crash the computer, I don't know. Then you would make a decorator that checks, for example, for these arguments, and simply apply this decorator to every single function you have, and thus, so you don't have to rewrite this check syntax for every single function. You make this reusable. So that's also a part of object-oriented programming. And we've seen how Python does decorators already when we talked about properties. It was this add property syntax, or in the setters and getters, add set add something dot getter, or like something like this. Okay, so let's try to understand the concept of decorators first. So I'm not showing you how Python does the decorators at first. I'm just showing you where we would start in understanding what decorators do and are. Okay, so imagine we have our function subtract, and this simply returns a subtraction. And now imagine we want to add behavior around this. And now around this, I mean literally, so the behavior I want to add around this is that I want to print the result of my function. I also want to print a line before that and a line after that, such that when I call the function, so if the semicolon doesn't give the out, it simply returns a line with this string, and then the line with the actual result, and then another line. And this is how we do it. We would define another function, decorated subtract, which takes any kind of arguments and keyword arguments because we're passing them to the subtract. We don't care what they are, we're passing them through the subtract function anyway. And we're storing the result. And then we are printing this line. Well, as a matter of fact, we could also print this line before, that doesn't matter. And then we print the result of the subtract function, and then we print something else, and then we also return the result. So returning here is important because we want the behavior of our decorated subtract, so the what it takes in and what it returns, we want to our decorator to be transparent, so we want that to be the same. Now this does the same thing as the subtract method function, but it added behavior to it. But what this also does is it creates a new function containing the change behavior of the very specific subtract function because we use the subtract function explicitly in here. What if we wanted to change the behavior of arbitrary functions with this decoration thingy? To do this, we would, for example, we could pass the function itself as an argument to our, so we make a decorated function, not a decorated subtract, but this decorated function gets passed whatever function it's going to execute and it's supposed to execute internally. Because this is possible in Python because functions are first order objects and we can just have references to function and work on these functions. So we can pass any arbitrary function here with an arbitrary amount and kind of args and keyword arguments. And then we execute this, and then we do the same stuff as before. So the only thing we change is that we got rid of the explicit dependence of the subtract method here. Now, just as well as we can make the decorated add function, we can call decorated with subtract 5 of 2. And this works just as well. Okay, so we'll step further to what we want to do, but still we didn't change the behavior of the subtract function. But what we did is we created a new function that takes an arbitrary function and makes something and puts something around this. Okay, to do this, so if we want to change the behavior of the add function or the subtract function itself, what we could do is we could create a new function that in the function body defines and returns another function, such that if we execute this, we redefine what the original is. So if we execute this, we get something as a result that is a function call. Okay, so we can do inner functions in Python, that's no problem at all. And how do we do this? Well, we define a decorator that takes as argument only the function, so not the arguments here, but only the function. So for example, subtract, and then defines an inner function. And this looks like we did before here, just actually it looks like this version, but the func arguments here comes from the outer scope already. And then this is basically as renewed already, this returns a result in the end. And the new function, and then we return something which is this inner function. Okay, so now we can call decorated egg add equals, so we assign the result of this print decorator to decorated add. And we assign the result of this print decorator with the argument add. So what is this result? The result is this function, where func is add. Okay, so we now, so this outer thingy here is called just once when we do this assignment operation. So we see at the parentheses, we execute the defined function outside here, this once when we assign it. And now this here is the result of the execution of this outer function, which is a reference to the inner function where func is add. Now we can simply call decorated add with the original argument. So now when we call decorated add, what we're calling is this inner function. And this then takes any parameters and passes it to the original function, which was add. So now if we call, if we execute all of this and then we call decorated add, this works. And this returns the same thing. So now this has the precisely same argument list as the original add function had, but has this additional behavior. And now there's only one step we're missing, and that is that we wanted to change the original function, not create a new function. So we can simply define add to be, and then the result of this, the print decorator of add. So now add is this function with the func argument being add. Now if we call add 3.5 with the original arguments, this is the result. We see here that this, so we have the additional behavior of every time when we call add, we additionally show these lines before and after. Okay, and this line here is only executed when we redefine the function, when we call the decorator with the function. And once we have this, this is not called anymore, but this add is not the outside function, but the outside function applied to the argument add, which is this inner function. Okay, now all this is when we use the decorator syntax in Python, we still have to do all this. It's just that Python provides some little piece of syntactic sugar for this very line, where we say function, or rather for this very, not for this, but for this line. We say original function equals decorator applied to original function. And this is this add syntax. This is syntactic sugar and doesn't actually add something to the language, but it's just another way of writing this here. Okay, so if we have now of, if we have a new function multiply, then instead of writing multiply, so instead of afterwards writing multiply equals and then print decorator of multiply, we write this syntax at the front, so before the function with the add. Now this has the same behavior. Now we have the print decorator now change the add, the subtract, and the multiply function in the same way transparently. We still get the same result as when we defined the function. We still take the same arguments as when we defined the functions, and we still use them, but we have additional behavior on this. And this is what the decorator pattern is supposed to be. So we're supposed to transparently and reproducibly change the behavior of a function to add some additional behavior. Let me give you another example to make that a bit more clear. So imagine we wanted to have, so imagine we have the function hello that simply prints hello world, and or rather it returns hello world. And if we have it in the last line of something, that also prints it. Now we want to add the behavior that around, keyword around, the results of this function. Now this is where the bells ring, this is where you use a decorator. Around the results of this function, decorator, around something else, concept, context manager. Around this, we want there to be this HTML tags to make stuff bold. So this is HTML, and if you render it with a browser, it will make it bold. Okay, so to do this, we have to define this function that inside it has another function. So first of all, this function outside needs as argument, it takes a function, and inside it, it returns an inner, it defines an inner function which changes the behavior of the original function, which does almost the same as the original function, but changes some kind of its behavior. In this case, well, we don't return simply, so if we didn't have, if we only returned fn, that would be precisely the same and our decorator would be precisely useless. But we add some behavior, and that is with, that we add this HTML bold tags around it. Okay, and this is what the new wrapped function, what the decorator function is supposed to do. Well, and then we put this all into this decorator thingy and return this when we call the decorator. And now we can simply add this decorator to our function which we had. So again, this is the same as saying hello equals bold of hello. Now if we look, if we execute bold of hello, this returns this function. So it is a new function that returns this tag plus the contents of our original the result of our original function plus this tag. Okay, now if we execute this, we have this the HTML syntax around this. By the way, in IPython notebooks and lab, you can import HTML from this. So this is how you import something from. So this is one of the many Python import syntaxes. And if we call HTML on something which has HTML tags, Jupyter renders it in HTML, which is really nice. Okay, so now that we did this, we can even chain decorators. So we already know this bold decorator, and the italic decorator works in much the same way. It just doesn't add the bold tags around this, but the italic tags, which is the I. Now we can chain these decorators. And what this simply does here, where this line says hello equals bold hello, and what this line then says is, well, hello equals bold italic, I mean, of. And then what we had before, so italic of bold, oops, of hello. And thus we have two decorators in the same thing. Okay, now that's almost it. So that's how decorators work, and that's what I do. But what we see here, if we execute this, we see that we lose the doc string. So if we look at the doc string, we see that we lose it, even though the original hello function did have a doc string. Okay, so if we replace the original function by the decorator version, we lose all information of the original function, including its doc string, about information about arguments, and etc., etc. As a matter of fact, we would get the doc string of this wrapped function. So if we had this as doc string, this would be our doc string. But this is not what we want, because we want to change the behavior of the original function transparently, and we want the doc string of the original function to stay the same. So what we can simply do for this is use this another decorator, which is already implemented in Python itself, and that's functools.webs. And this simply copies the docs of the original function to the new one. And we must import it again, so we can import from functools import webs. So this is the same as saying import functools.webs and then saying webs equals functools. So if we import it like this, we always have to write the dot functools. But if we did it like this, this would be the same. So this import from something, import something is syntactic sugar for this again. Python has just so much syntactic sugar, but it's awesome because it makes it so clear. Okay, and now we simply add this, add webs to the decorator function here and simply add that around, or rather before the definition of here. And this simply takes the arguments of the original function and the doxing and the information about arguments of the original function and applies it to this web function. Okay. There's something else we can see here, and this is that even these decorators allow for arguments. But if you write a decorator like this, like we did here, this makes sense. It's simply that this add webs decorator, when it's applied to a function, so this is applied to a function at to fn, and the result of applying webs to fn returns another function, which we then use to decorate. So we can let a function return a function if it gets argument of a function, and you know, so we can just apply that as many times and we can have as many inner functions as we want. And this is what's happening here. Not too important for you, but just use the add webs because then your doc string stays the same. And if we now write hello question mark, it will take the original doc string. Okay, and now we changed changed this HTML decorator here, which simply does what I did here and prints HTML off and then the result of the function, such that it's nicely rendered. So now we see we can comment out individual parts of this and then the result changes. Okay, as much for the theory, now I have one exercise for you, and that's simply to define and apply a generator that makes a string appear wet. And how do we do this in HTML? So the HTML syntax is that you have to wrap this tag spun style equals color wet, and then afterwards dspun around the original text. Alright, so the solution here is rather obvious, so we do precisely the same thing, so we copy simply these lines of code. Actually, if you apply decorators in real life, you're just copying other decorators we made before, seriously. Because I also forget always how this works with the inner function. But we simply replace the I or the B tag with the spun style equals color red tag. And then we can add that to our chain of decorators here for our function, and we see this works. Okay, I just want to give you one real-world example, and that is your dashboard. So I noticed where decorators are, for example, really useful is when you're doing websites and you want to require a login. So first of all, so in this dashboard, I'm using Flask, and Flask needs their own decorators, which, for example, simply makes sure that when I call the domain, whatever my domain is, slash logout GitHub, then this function is executed and it's going to return whatever this function is going to return. Okay, but this decorator is, for example, one I did myself. So this is the must login decorator, and I defined it right here. And what this simply does is it takes the original function, and then it makes sure that so there's a generate this. And if you're doing HTML, if you're doing web development stuff, you always have a session where there is information, for example, the access token, which is the information if you're logged in or not. Okay, and inside this decorator, I'm checking if the access token is there, and if it is there, then that means that you're allowed to be, so that you're logged in, and if it's not, it means you're not logged in. So I could add this to my original page. I could say if the access token is there, if the access token is there, then do whatever you want to do, and else return the redirection to the you're not logged in page. But now, if I wanted to do that for every single page I have, then I would have to repeat these three lines of codes for every page I have, and there could be more and more complex behavior, obviously, so the dashboard is really simply done. And in that case, it's a perfect scenario where I want to use a decorator. And now, if I have the decorator I wanted, this function is going to have this additional behavior that if the access token is in there, well, just do whatever the original function did. And if it's not, return me to the not logged in page. I think this is a rather good example of where you would actually use decorators, because here I'm actually saving three lines of code, well, instead of one, per function I'm using this on. And if I have a huge web page with many pages, it makes sense on the long run, obviously. All right, as much for decorators.